Having a nice lunch? Yeah? Yeah? Good. Do you ever feel tired at this time? Are you okay? Yes, a little bit tired? Yeah? Okay. They mopped the floor already? Really? Wow, amazing. Yeah. Was the toilet? Very, very efficient. Yeah, okay. Well done. That was okay. And you make good karma before the, you know, before the, it's great to make good karma during the retreat, yeah? Extra good karma, then you kind of get more oomph in your meditation practice. Everything kind of gets better that way. So that's wonderful. I'm really glad to hear that you are so efficient and so good. Next time you have to invite me as well, I can help mopping a little bit, you know? Make some good karma. Anyway, so let us continue with this marvelous sutta, the two kinds of thought, the Dvaita Vitaka Sutta, Majjhima Nikaya number 19. And we were just looking, before lunch, we were looking at how to overcome unwholesome thoughts, and we were looking a little bit at sensual desire and looking at how this is done using wisdom power rather than willpower. And this is kind of the main message of this sutta, how to use wisdom power rather than willpower to overcome unwholesome thoughts. And it's kind of radical. It's not something people usually think of. Although when you reflect on it carefully, you realize this is the sensible way to overcome the problems that we have in the mind that stop us from enjoying life, enjoying meditation and all of this. And then the very last sentence there, which I didn't really get to, which is important part of this, we're still on page 69, the kind of the second last paragraph there, and it says, whenever a thought of sensual desire arose in me, I abandoned it, removed it, did away with it. And these words that you see there, to abandon something, maybe not so much abandon, but to remove it and to do away with something, elsewhere even more strong words are used in English to translate these Pali words, like obliterate is used. Yeah, obliterate sounds like a very strong word. And the point is, it sounds like when you see those words, it sounds like you use a lot of willpower. Yeah, obliterate usually means you take a big kind of something and you kind of whack things, and then you obliterate things, you destroy it. It sounds like a lot of willpower, a lot of force, using a sledgehammer or something like that to obliterate something. Yeah. But what we have just seen now, which is so interesting, is that the way to obliterate things is precisely not by using force and willpower. The way to obliterate something, to remove it, abandon it, is by using wisdom power. This is fascinating, isn't it? Because it shows us sometimes how careful we have to be when we read the suttas. We tend to infer certain things, or we tend to put certain meanings into the words which may not be there. And this is why you have to be so careful sometimes. These particular words, they also occur in other places where the context is not so clear that it means using wisdom. Here the context is very clear. Other places it is not. Because of that, we then kind of get the idea here that what is often meant by this is using wisdom power. And when you think about it, it actually makes incredibly good sense. And this is kind of the thing to really understand, why wisdom power is so much preferable to willpower. Because when you use willpower to kind of push aside a bad thought, or you know, you kind of suppress it a little bit or whatever, what happens when you use willpower? Two things happen. One is like suppression, when you hold something down, yeah? It's like you have a kettle that is boiling and you take the lid and you try to hold it down. It doesn't take long before the steam builds up and it almost explodes out of that kettle. Yeah, you can suppress it for a few moments, but it doesn't take long before it comes back up again. And it's exactly the same thing. If you try to suppress your mind when you are angry, or you even when you have desires in the mind, you try to hold it down, it doesn't take that long before it comes back with a vengeance. Yeah, and then it kind of bang, it really hits you. And there are people who kind of go way too far with suppression, and they often end up with psychological difficulties. You suppress parts of your personality, and they may kind of look peaceful on the surface, but occasionally they really explode completely because there is an imbalance there, basically, in how they deal with their mental issues. So if you, this is the problem with suppression. Yeah, it cannot be, it tends to come back again with a vengeance. Sometimes you can use it in certain circumstances, if there is a very big problem, or there, you know, there is no other way of dealing with it or whatever. So in very occasionally it might be okay. But generally speaking, the idea of using willpower tends to be counterproductive. And not only is it counterproductive, but it takes a lot of energy, yeah? If you can hold something down using force, it depletes your energy very a lot. It doesn't take long before you become very tired if you have to hold things down and suppress them in this way. But when you use wisdom power, what happens is that the because you see the problem for what it is like it is naturally abandoned in the mind. Yeah, when you understand that there is a problem with getting angry and you really get that, it's like the problem just disappears completely. It's like I was saying before, the idea when you put your hand on something hot, you pick up a hot coal or something by accident, you don't know it's hot, you don't really need to think that you have to let go of it, you just let go automatically. In the same way, if you see something is dukkha, something is problematic, then you don't actually have to suppress anything. The wisdom just abandons it just like that, and it goes. And that is very powerful, yeah, because it means that when it is abandoned in that way, there's no suppression. It is just gone, and very often it is gone for a long time as a consequence. So this is a far better, far more powerful way of doing things. Also, it depletes much less energy. Yeah, all you have to do really is to turn your mind in the right direction. The problem with wisdom power is that it takes more time to develop. This is the biggest problem with wisdom power. You don't have it straight away. You need to develop a particular way of looking at the world, of looking at the people around you. And as you develop that, then your ability to use this starts to kind of arise and become, you're actually able to use these things. So this is the difficulty with wisdom power. You need to develop it more. This is what I will be looking at tomorrow in particular, how to deal with things like anger and upset. How can we look at people in a different way? Yeah, and it's not that hard. This is kind of the weird thing. People think that anger is a natural thing. We always, sometimes you just have to get angry and upset by things, but actually, not really. Yeah, it is possible to deal with these things in a way whereby you'd only have to get angry very, very rarely. And this is the beauty of this. So you just have to put these things into practice. So wisdom power is much more efficient in obliterating, removing, abandoning, annihilating these states than much better than willpower is. As we saw in that other sutta the other day, we had a look at the idea of using mind to suppress mind. Occasionally you do that. If you are really at your wit's end, you don't know what to do because you are about to do something really bad, then you say, okay, suppress. Don't want to see. You suppress it out of your mind and then you are okay as a consequence. But usually I use it as a very last resort. You try everything else first. If everything else fails, then you can use a bit of suppression and willpower. As I said, if you are just about to kill somebody, then hold back. Don't kill. Yeah, I'm not suggesting that you do that every day, but I'm just, So anyway, so there you are. So that is how it is done, and that is using sensual desire as the example. As I mentioned before, it is much more important, obviously, with ill will. And so the passage repeats itself with ill will and then with ruthlessness or cruelty, as it says here, as the alternative. So let us just just read through it quickly with the alternative. The two other alternatives. As I abided thus, heedful, energetic, and with effort, a thought of ill will, or ill will arose in me, a thought of ruthlessness or harmfulness arose in me. I understood thus, this thought of ruthlessness has arisen in me. It leads to my own affliction, to others' affliction, and to the affliction of both. It obstructs wisdom, causes difficulties, and leads away from Nibbana. When I considered thus, it subsided in me. Whenever a thought of being ruthless or lacking in compassion arose in me, I abandoned it, removed it, did away with it. So again, a similar kind of idea. You understand that ill will is going to lead to your own affliction. Yeah, if you are angry, it leads to your affliction. Why? Well, it leads to your affliction because anger is a much worse mental state than being peaceful and nice and having metta. It doesn't feel anywhere near as good. When you're angry, your outlook is distorted. You start doing stupid things as a consequence of anger. That's why we often have regret after we have done something in anger. Anger leads to a destruction in our relationships with the people around us and with society at large. Anger has a lot of really detrimental, bad effects. So it doesn't take all that much insight to understand the harmful effects of anger. But really, again, it is something that you should contemplate, because it may not always be clear. Yeah, people think, oh, I got to be angry with my children sometimes to kind of set them straight. We have one of the ladies here. Is she here now? Who was asking about one of her children. That it's very hard to bring up children without sometimes getting angry. And that's probably true. It probably is very, very hard, because sometimes, you know, it is difficult. But it doesn't mean that it is ideal. It doesn't mean that it is necessary. And if we can avoid it, it's even better. So that is where you have to see the problem. Yeah. And then when you see the problem, then you can move away from it. If you don't recognize it as a problem, there's no chance at all that you're ever going to overcome it. If you think it is required, you think it's a good thing, then of course it's not going to. You're never going to be able to overcome these things. So you have to find the incentive first. So reflect on the detriment, reflect on the harmfulness, and then that is really what this is about. And ruthlessness, the same thing, not caring about others. Having a lack of compassion in your heart is exactly the same thing here. So I'm going to leave it at that, because I already went through it at length just before the meal. And now let us continue on this sutta with the remainder parts of it. And then the Buddha says, bhikkhus, whatever a bhikkhu, or anyone else for that matter, frequently thinks and ponders upon, that will become the inclination of their mind. If you frequently think and ponder upon sensuality, one has abandoned the thought of giving up desire to cultivate the thought of sensuality. And then the mind inclines to sensuality. If you frequently think and ponder upon thoughts of ill will or being ruthless, you abandon the thought of non-ruthlessness or of compassion to cultivate the thought of ruthlessness, and then the mind incline towards ruthlessness. And this is a very important principle to understand, because what this means is that the path is always most difficult in the beginning. It is difficult because we tend to have very strong tendencies in our mind, very strong habits. We kind of get born with a certain level of defilements, and that level of defilements tends just to continue unless we do something about it. So what this shows you is that what we need to do is to try to counteract some of our habits. And then as you create new habits, those new states become natural for you, and that becomes the tendency of your mind. Yeah, so it is really about creating new habits is actually a very important part of this. So in a way, you can, you know, we are like kind of these big ocean liners, you know, with a fully laden with hundreds of thousands of tons of oil or iron ore or whatever it is, and we're kind of heading in one direction. The momentum is very powerful and strong. It takes a long time to turn around one of those iron ore cargo ships, because the weight is so enormous, and we are like these iron ore cargo ships. Do you feel like an iron ore cargo ship? Big ships, very heavy. The habit, the tendency is very strong. So you start turning it around. Yeah, you turn a little bit. You start thinking, instead of thinking thoughts of ill will, you start to think, wait a minute, is there another way of looking at this? And as you find another way, the ship turns a little bit. And then you do it again, and a little bit more, and a little bit more. Until eventually the ship turns all the way around, 180 degrees, is heading in exactly the opposite direction. And then it is heading in the opposite direction, but with exactly the same momentum. So now it is difficult to think thoughts of ill will. You can only think thoughts of metta. That's pretty good, isn't it? Can't, oh, I can't have any ill will anymore. Let me try. No, don't try. Yeah, if you can't have ill will, it's good. No need to try to get the ill will up. So this is kind of the beauty of this, is that it's difficult in the beginning. But as you learn to recondition yourself and to redo this, you start heading a different direction. You are literally becoming a new person. You're becoming someone else. And it's not scary, it's good. You feel much better in your own skin because now you feel more wholesome. You feel better because of this changing of direction and creating new habits for yourself. So this is kind of what, in part, this is like. And sometimes people think this is impossible to do. And one of the reasons why we tend to think of these things as impossible is because of our sense of self. The sense of self tells you that the way you are now is the way you have to be. Yeah, this is kind of what the self is. The self is this feeling that you are something and that will continue into the future. There's a permanent essence to you. Whatever habits you have now, they are your essence and then will have to carry on in the future. So sometimes it can be hard to see the potential for change precisely because we identify with what we already have. So don't be fooled by that silly sense of self. Realize that some days you wake up, you feel really good. Yeah, you want to give a hug to the whole world. Have you ever woken up and feel, oh, I want to give everyone a hug? Sometimes you feel like really kind. Yeah, you feel kind of really, whoa, you feel so good. Now that can be the new you. You can be like that all the time. And then your good moments can be even better. Yeah, remember that. So look at the kind of fluctuations in your mind as they are now. And the best person you can be like that all the time. And the new best person is even better than you can even fathom right now. And so it goes on and on. And you change in this way gradually. But it's difficult. It is difficult precisely because we are this cargo ship heading down with this massive momentum in a certain direction. Changing our habits is hard. It takes work. Yeah, it takes reflection. And as you do so, it happens. And one of the consequences of that is that we understand it's not only for us that it is hard to change direction or change habits, it's hard for everyone. Yeah, so we stop being so demanding of people around us. Very often we want other people, yeah, our husband or wife or children or whatever, we want them to be different. But are we really being realistic? Can they be different? If they are really stupid and are getting all C's in school, but we want them to have A's, is it going to work? Maybe not. So sometimes it just doesn't work. We have demands and we demand things of others that we can't even do with ourselves. So stop thinking that other people can change. Maybe they can, maybe they can't, but often it is impossible to gauge, impossible to know. It's difficult enough to change ourselves. Let the focus be on ourselves. Then we can actually do something. So these are kind of important implications of this, of the habits being strong, is how we actually deal with ourselves and also deal with other people around us. So this is what happens, and this is why this process is very fruitful and why, you know, we keep on doing it and why it is so delightful when you start changing. Wow, it is such a wonderful thing to see these things happening within you. So and then he has this beautiful simile here to explain what is going on. Just as in the last month of the rainy season, in the autumn, when the crops thicken, a cowherd would guard his cows by constantly tapping and poking them on this side and that with a stick to check and curb them. Why is that? Because he sees that he could be flogged, imprisoned, fined, or blamed if he let them stray into the crops. So too, I saw in unwholesome qualities danger, degradation, and defilement, and in wholesome qualities the blessing of renunciation, the aspect of cleansing. The cowherd, you are the cowherd, yeah? And the cow is your mind. Yeah, so you are guarding your mind. And the guard is really mindfulness. And the crops thicken. Well, the crops are all those places where you don't want your mind to go. Yeah, go to anger and that kind of stuff. So you're always tapping and poking the mind a little bit on this side. Okay, go this way, go that way. That's what you say to your mind. But using wisdom power, not willpower. And this way you check and curb the mind. Why is that? Because you see that you could be flogged, imprisoned, and fined, and blamed if you stray into the crops. In other words, you will suffer as a consequence. And this is what the Buddha is saying here. So you restrain your mind, and then you avoid that suffering in the future as a consequence. It's a nice little simile. You kind of, your mind is like a cow. Yeah, and it's kind of nice because sometimes we think of, you know, people. We think that human beings, we are much smarter than cows, and that's true. In a sense, we are smarter than cows, but at the same time, we are also followers of habits, just like cows. And cows, they just kind of, you know, they go moo, and then they kind of walk into the field, and then they kind of follow their kind of animal habits, and they don't really think too much about what is going on. And we tend to, very often people are a little bit like that. We tend to follow our own habits. So even though we are smarter in one way, we also have that cow nature is also there to some extent. So it's good to remember that, this tendency to just follow old habits, which is always there very powerfully. Then you have this nice this description here of the unwholesome qualities of mind, seeing the danger, degradation, and defilement in these states. The danger, obviously, we have already been talking about, adinava in Pali, and so that is the danger of suffering and going off the spiritual path and all of that. And then you have the degradation. You are degraded, okara in Pali. And okara is like to make low, yeah, to kind of make something lower than it actually is. And this is one of those things that you look at your mind, and when you see it is full of defilements or whatever, it kind of feels lower, it feels less noble. It feels like, you know, you are a kind of, belong to a lower part of human society almost. But a mind that is pure, a mind that is happy, a mind that is bright and energetic, it has a degree of nobility to it. Yeah, it is nobility and the anti-nobility that you're seeing here. You feel more noble, you feel more energetic, you feel all of these wonderful qualities. And it actually, you know that this is a good thing. That's the way it feels, and also the way, of course, it tends to turn out as well. And defilement, yeah, you are kind of defiled. It's the same kind of thing with these qualities. Then you have the blessing of renunciation and cleansing, because that's the exact opposite. So if the other things are degraded and dangerous, then the blessing is to renounce those things and to clean up your act and clean up your mind, so to speak. Then that is the first part of this sutta, and that is the part which has to do with overcoming the unwholesome thoughts. And now we come to the second part, and the second part is about the opposite, what happens further on. Once the unwholesome thoughts have been overcome, then it is the next step that happens. And this is what the Buddha has to say. As I abided thus, heedful, energetic, and with effort, a thought of renunciation arose in me. I understood thus, this thought of non-desire or renunciation has arisen in me. This does not lead to my own affliction or to others' affliction or to the affliction of both. It aids wisdom, does not cause difficulties, and it leads to nibbana. If I think and ponder upon this thought, even for a night, even for a day, even for a night and day, I see nothing to fear from it. But with excessive thinking and pondering, I might tire my body. And when the body is tired, the mind becomes strained. And when the mind is strained, it is far from stillness. So I steadied my mind internally, quieted it, brought it to singleness, and stilled it. Why is that? So that my mind should not be strained. So here we have now overcome the unwholesome qualities, you see in your mind, you see all these positive qualities, like the quality of renunciation. It can just be considered like the quality of non-desire or lack of desire is one way of looking at it. Or it could perhaps be something more active, such as the actual wanting to give things up. You know, that's possible as well. But most of the time probably just means that there is a lack of desire there, especially in the realm of the five senses. But there may be desire to go on retreat, maybe desire to listen to the Dhamma, desire to wash the floor, Yeah, that is good kind of desire, because these are desires of that actually leads you in the right direction. Desires of service, desires of kindness, desires of spiritual life. These are positive things. And he says right away, there's no problem with these things. They don't lead to suffering. In fact, they lead to the exact opposite. They aid wisdom. Yeah, isn't that kind of nice? They aid wisdom. And the same thing with the thoughts that come afterwards. This is just the thought of non-desire, which is a little bit hard to grasp exactly what that means. It's not so obvious. But later on we have the thought of non-ill will, which is like metta, or the thought of non-ruthlessness. Yeah? In other words, compassion. Yeah, so these thoughts of metta and compassion, they aid wisdom. Whenever you have a thought of kindness towards somebody, whenever you want to help someone, whenever you want to be friendly to somebody, whenever you want to do something positive, even have a kind thought, you're aiding wisdom. Yeah, isn't that wonderful? So if you want to be wise, this is exactly what you have to do. You have to change that freight train and head in the way of kindness and metta and compassion. And then you're actually helping wisdom. And as I said before, there's something very beautiful about the word wisdom. Wisdom means all the good things in the world, because this is what enables us to live in harmony, to live with kindness for each other, to live with happiness and avoid suffering. That is exactly what wisdom is. And this is why wisdom is far more useful than intelligence. Intelligence is nice, but intelligence doesn't necessarily mean that you are using that intelligence wisely. You can be using it in stupid ways. You know, you have like the, you know, people who use intelligence to create atomic bombs and that kind of thing. Yeah, so you can use intelligence in many different ways. But when intelligence is used in the field of psychology to enable you to live well, to do the right thing, then it becomes wisdom, and that is the kind of wisdom that is what really matters, because that actually gives you quality of life. Intelligence, you may have a miserable life and be really intelligent, but if you are wise, you can by definition not have a miserable life. Wisdom leads to happiness by definition, and this is why it is so beautiful. It helps you and others to be happy and to live well. It aids wisdom, does not cause difficulties, and leads to nibbana. Yeah, if you have a thought of kindness to someone, it leads to nibbana. You're heading for nibbana. Whenever you sit down and say, may all beings be happy and well, not just say it, but mean it, yeah, in a deep sense, that is kind of the hard part with it. If you really mean it, you're heading to nibbana. It makes you very, isn't that kind of nice? May all beings be happy and well. Wow, this is the highway to nibbana. Yeah, it's so beautiful, and it's very happy at the same time. And what a wonderful thing that is. So it leads to nibbana. But then comes the downside, and this is kind of the interesting part here, where he says that if he thinks and ponders upon this for a whole day or night, there's nothing to fear from it. But with excessive thinking and pondering, you will tire the body. Yeah, and the body and the mind are very closely related to each other. It's not exactly clear what is meant by body here. Maybe mind just means consciousness, and body might mean the other aspects of the mind. It's not entirely clear. But the mind and the body get strained and tired as a consequence of this. And when the body and mind are strained and tired, they are far from stillness. They are far from concentration. Why is that? Because stillness or samadhi is a state of alertness, a state of energy, a state of awareness. It is the opposite of being tired. So if you are even physically tired, if you work too hard, you use your brain too much, in whatever way it is, it's going to stop you from being able to achieve stillness and samadhi as a consequence. Yeah. So this is why we come home after a long day's work, because you have been using your brain and using your mind and your body all the time, and brain is part of the body, then of course it's going to be hard to meditate. You come in, you start nodding. And that's okay. So nod. Allow that tiredness to go. Don't fight the nodding. If you're fighting, you're just making it worse, because you're straining it even more. Now you can see the connection there, why you actually need to rest, to allow tiredness to come to get dissipate, and then the possibility of meditation happens as a consequence after that. It's kind of obvious when you think about it. So thinking, using the mind, is problematic in all situations. Even if you have good thoughts, it is problematic simply because the mind gets tired by too much thinking. But what we are seeing here, one of the important points to take away from this is that the purification of the mind and the movement towards samadhi and the whole movement of the Noble Eightfold Path, it follows a certain pattern. And you have to get things in the right sequence. If you get things in the wrong sequence, it's not going to work. And what very often happens that people, they go to the meditation center, sit down, okay, watch the breath. It's not going to work because you haven't really done the preliminary work yet. Yeah, you haven't actually followed the kind of the instruction manual. The instruction manual says, first of all, you start with the coarsest aspects in your conduct. This is why we start off with keeping the 5 precepts, or the 8 precepts, or the 10 precepts, or the 227, or the 311, or whatever it is, precepts. We start with that. We start to refine our conduct. Then we go to how we think about things. This is the second stage. We learn to think about other people with kindness and compassion and understanding. This is a second level. Once that is gone, this is what this sutta is saying, then you abandon the kind of very refined and remaining thoughts. Yeah, even the thoughts that are kind. So you have to do it in the right sequence. You get the sequence wrong. If you try to go straight to samadhi and straight to meditation practice, which is what many people do, it's not going to work. It's just impossible. So you're never going to get those kind of insights or the depth of samadhi that is required for real insight because you haven't followed the instruction manual. So this shows you the importance, again, of coming back to the word of the Buddha, because it is just so helpful in terms of many of these small details, getting things right in the right sequence. And even when you deal with the defilements of the mind, start off with the coarser defilements. Look inside of you what your main problem is. Know yourself well. Yeah, what are your main problems? Have you a tendency to get upset? Have you got too much kind of desire for all kind of worldly things? Are you a little bit confused and deluded? Look at your mind. Know where your problems are. What are the person that upset you the most? How can you neutralize that? How can you look at these people in a new way to neutralize these negative feelings? And as you understand yourself, and this is an important part, to have self-insight is a very important part of the path. You neutralize those defilements, get on to the next defilements, and gradually you purify yourself in this way. And one day you sit down, your meditation becomes better. This doesn't mean you shouldn't do any meditation while this process is happening. You can, but you shouldn't expect the meditation to become very profound. You use it for a little bit of peace, for a little bit of happiness, but you don't say, when are the jhanas going to come? You don't say that, ask that question anymore, because you realize, actually, it's the wrong question to ask. I should ask instead, what are the defilements in the mind that are remaining? Deal with those, and then gradually the meditation will happen as a consequence. So this is an important, I think a very important part of the path that people sometimes forget. And one of the things with some teacher like Ajahn Brahm, I know what Ajahn Brahm is like. He says, oh, sit down, just follow the breath, and bang, the nimittas come up and you go into jhana. That's what he says, because that's what he does. But I think he was born from the Brahma realm or something. That must be why he's called Brahmavangso. Brahmavangso literally means the lineage of Brahma, yeah? So I think he was probably born from there. So for him, he's always had an easy meditation time. For the vast majority of people, it is not as easy as it is for him. So he thinks that everyone is like him. That's what he thinks. So you sit down, relax, bang, and you are all there. But so you have to, sometimes you have to know that, okay, this works for a tiny, tiny minority of people, but the vast majority of people, we have to be more, focus more on our defilements and overcome problems that are already there, and then the path starts to work. Yeah, that's my, don't tell Ajahn Brahm I said this, because I get into trouble, but because the problem is, and this is kind of one of the reasons why the way the Buddha speaks and the way contemporary and other people speak is slightly different. Because most teachers, they have their kind of way of doing things that fits their personality, yeah? Or fits their development prior to being born into this world. Whereas the Buddha, the amazing thing with him is that he gives a full outline of the Buddhist path. So all character traits, no matter who you are, will fall into this teaching somewhere or not. Whereas that is not always true with more contemporary teachers, they will often teach more according to just their personal traits and how they do things. And this is one of the reasons why it is so useful to come back to the word of the Buddha and not just follow modern meditation techniques or specific teachers and all of these kind of things. So Ajahn Brahm is extraordinarily inspiring, and the way he practices is very, very impressive. But I'm not sure if he always relates perfectly to, you know, to people who are having more difficulties with their practice. That's just my opinion, and I'm happy to be wrong about that. But that's the way it seems to me. Anyway, so let us carry on. So where did we get to? Okay, there. So then. Because you realize your mind is far from concentration, then he stills it. He steadies it internally and quiets it and brings it to singleness and stills it so that it should not be strained. And this is what he's doing here. So basically he's teaching, he's following some kind of meditation object that then leads to samadhi. And when the mind goes into samadhi, then it gains the power and it gains all the qualities that is required for, you know, taking it all the way to the end of the path, obviously. So this is what this is about. And this is how you get to this particular point. And then he has the simile again. And bhikkhus, he says, whatever a bhikkhu frequently thinks and ponders upon, that will be the inclination of their mind. If they frequently think and ponder upon the thought of non-desire, then they have abandoned the thought of desire, to cultivate the thought of non-desire. And then his mind inclines to thoughts of non-desire. If he frequently thinks and ponders upon thoughts of non-ill will, or thoughts of non-harming or of being compassionate, then he has abandoned the thought of being harsh, to cultivate the thought of non-harshness, and then his mind inclines to non-harshness. So here your big ocean liner has finally turned itself around, heading in a different direction, and now you cannot help yourself, you have to think thoughts of kindness. When you see someone doing something stupid, instead of getting angry, you have compassion, because you realize, actually, they are the one who have a problem. There's no point in getting angry with them. The right attitude is compassion, rather than doing that. And then you are heading in a different way. And then we have the simile again. Just as in the last month of the hot season, when all the crops have been brought inside the village, a cowherd would guard his cows while staying at the root of a tree or out in the open, since he only needs to be mindful that the cows are there. So too, there was need for me only to be mindful that those qualities were there. So this is nice to be a cowherd when all you have to do is sit at the root of a tree. You don't have to do very much, you just watch the cows. The cows are peacefully grazing out on the green, all happy, they're not kind of straying in the wrong place. And that is your mind. Your mind is not straying anywhere. It is a kind of a nice, peaceful cow doing grazing in the right place, looking at the positive qualities of other people, having compassion for others when you see that they do stupid things. That is where your mind gets to. And your mind is grazing in the right area. And all you have to do is watch. You sit back, you watch your mind, and there's no need to nudge it or do anything with it. You know it is in the right place. And then you have the foundation stones are in place for attaining meditation, for watching the breath, for doing Satipatthana practice, for doing the seven factors of awakening, and all of that happens as a consequence. Then the Buddha says, tireless energy was aroused in me, and unremitting mindfulness was established. My body was tranquil and untroubled, and my mind stilled and unified. And these states are things that always tend to come together. When you overcome the defilements of the mind, the energy gets aroused, as a consequence. Tireless energy, this energy that you feel can just carry on forever. And the reason it looks that way is because the defilements are gone. As long as the defilements are gone, the energy will be tireless. This is kind of the point. With that energy comes the mindfulness. The energy and the mindfulness are two aspects very often of the same thing. When you are energetic, the mind is happy. The happy mind is energetic. And when you have energy and you're happy, you're also mindful. And it shows you that if you really are going to be mindful, you cannot really force it. You have to give rise to this state where there is a sense of happiness, gladness combined with energy. All of these things happen through cultivation of the mind and not really through using force. So these things tend to be there together. And that's why you can see these qualities tend to arise together. And then the body is tranquil and untroubled. This is what we saw before, the tranquility of the body in the transcendental dependent arising or dependent liberation, where the mind gets very close to samadhi, everything becomes tranquil and quiet, and the mind becomes stilled as a consequence. And then the sutta carries on. I have left out parts of the sutta carries on, and then the Buddha goes on to practicing the four jhanas. After the four jhanas, he goes on to practice the insights, the vijja, and he remembers his past lives, he understands the laws of karma, and then ultimately he sees the Four Noble Truths, and bang, that is when he reaches awakening. So really it is the Buddha teaching the whole path of awakening, starting out with a mind that is problematic, starting out with a mind where there is defilements and problems, and then eventually going all the way to awakening. So he's saying we should do the same. That's what he's saying here. We should practice in the same way, and eventually we will also get there. So that is the sutta, the Dvaita Vitakka Sutta, the two kinds of thoughts. So that is, I think, all I want to say about that. Does anyone have any questions about this? Would anyone like to? Does anyone want to say anything here? So everyone is happy with that? Okay, good. Cindy, do you want to bring up the question you had this morning, or are you, no, you want to leave it out? Okay, good, okay. So, okay, that's great. So in that case, I think we will just stop there. It's a little bit, few minutes early. I find it hard to make every session exactly 1 hour, but that's okay. We'll see you back again at 4 o'clock. And in the meantime, just keep on enjoying yourself. And then we will take it from there when we come back in at 4 o'clock. Okay.